Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I want to thank you all for being here today. I also, with my directors are here with me today. Director Karsten's here. Acting Director Tidball is here. Director Zellers is here. And Director Williams is here again today. I just want to be able to say there are many people working around the clock right now, you all included. And we appreciate your time and commitment as we continue working together to combat COVID-19. Today, there are three things I would like to address. The social distancing order I announced in yesterday's briefing, the regulatory updates regarding child care, and the updates from the Missouri Department of Revenue. I will turn it over to Director Jennifer Tidball and Director Zellers towards the end of my remarks. As I announced yesterday, I have directed the Department of Health and Senior Services Director Randall Williams to order social distancing statewide. I told you we would come back today with more details. Here are the details. The order requires the following. In accordance with the guidance from the President and the Centers of Disease Control and Prevention, every person in the state of Missouri shall avoid social gathering of more than 10 people. For the purpose of this order, social gatherings shall mean any planned or spontaneous event or meeting that would bring together more than 10 people in a single space at the same time. In accordance with the guidelines from the President and the Centers of Disease Control and Prevention, every person in the state of Missouri shall avoid eating or drinking at restaurants, bars, or food courts, provided, however, that the use of drive-through, pickup, or delivery options is allowed throughout the duration of this order. In accordance with the guidelines from the President and the Centers of Disease Control and Prevention, people shall not visit nursing homes, long-term care facilities, retirement homes, or assisted living homes, unless to provide critical assistance. In accordance with the guidelines from the President and the Centers of Disease Control and Prevention, all schools shall remain closed. This order does not prohibit people from visiting a variety of places, so long as necessary precautions are taken and maintained to reduce the transmission of COVID-19, including maintaining at least 6 feet of distance between all individuals that are not family members. For offices and workplaces that remain open, individuals shall practice good hygiene and, where feasible, work from home in order to achieve isolation from COVID-19. The more that people reduce their public contact, the sooner COVID-19 will be contained and the sooner this order will expire. This order will take effect beginning at 12:01 a.m. Monday, March the 23rd, 2020, and it will remain in effect until 12:01 a.m. Monday, April the 6th, 2020, unless extended by further order of the Director of the Department of Health and Senior Services, with said extensions not to exceed the duration of the effective period of the executive order. Now, let me give you a little update from DSS and DOR. As COVID-19 outbreak continues to develop, child care has become a major concern. To help with this, the Department of Health and Senior Services and the Department of Social Services have taken regulatory action to assist child care providers and families. DHSS section of child care regulation has taken the following steps. During the period of time that schools are closed, licensed child care providers are able to utilize the rules regarding emergency school closing. This allows licensed programs to accommodate enrolled school-aged children who need care. The provider will be permitted to exceed the licensed capacity of the facility by one-third during this time. DHSS has also developed a process to allow for the temporary care of preschool and school-age children. Also, short-term licensing for 45-day period will be available. These licenses, which are renewable, will be based on the abbreviated inspection that focuses on key health and safety indicators. Additionally, DHSS has loosened some regulations for licensed child care providers to allow them to extend their hours of care and ease the administrative burdens related to record keeping requirements. The Department of Social Services has also taken several actions to assist with child care needs. Child care subsidy program benefits are now extended for 90 days. The child care subsidy program can pay for additional hours of care for a child's attendance due to school closure or a parent being required to work additional hours. Child care subsidy provider application renewals will be extended 90 days. The Missouri Department of Revenue has also taken steps to assist those impacted by COVID-19. DOR will provide special payment relief to individuals and corporations in response to the COVID-19 outbreak. The department is also implementing automatic extensions for expiring driver's license and motor vehicle registrations to help alleviate public congestion in local license offices. These extensions are effective immediately. I will now turn this over to Acting Director Tidball to give an update.
Thank you, Governor. Good afternoon. I just want to reiterate what Governor Parsons said as far as our Department of Social Services working hand in hand daily with the Department of Health and Senior Services to support both child care providers and families in need of child care during this time. As the governor stated, we are extending child care benefits for 90 days to individuals who are currently eligible. We are extending the application time frame for providers who may want to be subsidy eligible or who are subsidy eligible, to 90 days. I also wanted to touch on a couple of other programs that I think are important in light of the situation that we're under. Department of Social Services does a lot of work around food insecurity for Missourians. Two programs that we're working on right now are related to the SNAP benefit. So you may know this is the food stamp benefit. Our Department of Social Services is responsible for administering that benefit. The federal law that passed, the Families First Coronavirus Response Act, that was signed by President Trump on Wednesday, included two additional temporary SNAP benefits for Missouri families. That first benefit is known as PSNAP. What PSNAP does is for households who are already eligible for food stamps, it increases their maximum allotment for both March and April. So, for example, we might have a household of three that is receiving less than $509. Every household of three that is currently eligible for SNAP will receive the maximum amount of $509 during March and during April. The other benefit that we will be able to administer during this time is a special benefit for families who are eligible for free and reduced lunch programs. So what that means is during the months of March, April, and May, we will be able to provide an additional SNAP benefit to those families. Families who we already know through the SNAP program will automatically receive that benefit. Families that we do not know, we will be reaching out to the school districts and to other local community providers to help us get those families into our offices, but actually calling on the phone and being able to get them eligible for this temporary benefit. The other item that I want to touch on food insecurity is we want to try to ease the burden that families have right now in being able to access SNAP benefits and maintain SNAP benefits. So we have pending waivers at the federal government that would basically lessen the steps that families have to take when they apply to actually be made eligible for benefits. Doesn't change the eligibility requirements, it just is less administrative burdensome for families. The waiver that we did get approved just today actually allowed us to extend recertification for families who are already eligible by 6 months. So what that means to a family is if we were going to review their case in March, we will now extend that review until September. And that waiver will be in place for families who were going to be reviewed both in March, April, and May. We may also be able to request additional extension as we see what happens in this situation. Finally, the last thing that I do want to touch on is our agency is also responsible for child welfare. During this time, we've seen a substantial decrease in our hotlines. We typically do see this when we have school out, but it's much more substantial than we would have expected. So I just want to remind the community today that our child abuse and neglect hotline remains open. We will not close. We operate a 7-day-a-week, 24-hour hotline. And I want to give the community that number. It is 800-392-3738. We understand during these time frames, families are sheltering close together. Children are just, there's just a lot of anxiety, and we just want to make sure that we as a community and we as Missourians are able to keep kids safe. You can call and report anonymously. You do not have to keep your name or provide your name. Thank you.
Thank you, Jennifer. Director Zellers, you want to go next and give them a little briefing on the Department of Revenue?
Thank you, Governor. Good afternoon. I'm Ken Zellers, Director of the Missouri Department of Revenue. The health and safety of Missourians is the department's top priority. In an effort to ease customer concerns and encourage social distancing, the department is announcing the following changes. First, mirroring the federal guidelines issued by the IRS, the Missouri Department of Revenue will provide special tax filing and payment relief to individuals and corporations. The deadline to file income tax returns has been extended from April 15th of 2020 to July 15th of 2020. Additionally, income tax payment deadlines for individuals and corporate income returns with a due date of April 15th, 2020 are extended until July 15th of 2020. This payment relief applies to all individual income tax returns filed by C corporations, and income tax returns filed by trusts or estates. The Department of Revenue will automatically provide this relief, so filers do not need to take any additional steps to qualify. This relief for individuals and corporations will also include estimated tax payments for the year 2020 that are due on April 15th of 2020. Second, to help alleviate public congestion in local license offices, the department has implemented automatic extensions for expiring driver's licenses and motor vehicle registrations. These extensions are effective immediately. Vehicle owners with registrations or license plates expiring in March and April have been granted an automatic 2-month extension. Owners will be able to continue operating their vehicles on Missouri roadways without penalty until they can apply for renewal. For example, vehicle owners with license plates expiring this month in March of 2020 will have until May 31st of 2020 to renew their license plates. The time frame in which vehicle safety and emissions inspection is valid for March and April license plate expirations has also been extended an additional 60 days. And applicants for title will not be assessed a late title penalty when visiting license offices, effective immediately. This waiver will continue through April 30th of 2020. Third, valid Missouri driver's license, non-driver's license, and non-commercial instructional permits with original expiration dates of March 1st of 2020 through April 30th of 2020 have been granted an automatic 60-day extension. For example, a driver license that expires on March 1st of 2020 will be considered valid until April 30th of 2020. Similarly, a driver's license that expires on April 30th, 2020 will be considered valid until June 29th of 2020. These licenses and permits will be considered to have valid status for driving and local document acceptance purposes. The approved extension does not waive the mandatory retesting requirements for persons who have allowed their license to expire for more than 184 days. Also, individuals who were provided notice to complete additional testing as part of a medical review program requirement may be granted an additional 60 days to comply with such requirements. Finally, I want to remind everyone the Department of Revenue has a variety of online resources and services which may be especially helpful at this time, and they can be found at our website at dor.mo.gov. Thank you.
Ken, thank you very much. Now the Director of Department of Public Safety, Director Karsten.
Thank you, Governor. As I have done previously this week, I've given updates on PPE or personal protective equipment, and I'm going to do that as well. And I will also provide additional information regarding expectations for those calling 911. Today, we've fulfilled 123 facility orders of personal protective equipment out of the Strategic National Stockpile. 101 of those were hospitals and 22 were emergency medical service providers. The Strategic National Stockpile is for hospitals, EMS, as well as long-term care facilities. We have a large number of requests that we are still working through at the warehouse today with people from Department of Health and Senior Services, the State Emergency Management Agency, as well as MoDOT. In addition, today we received federal guidance from FEMA regarding personal protective equipment for fire and law enforcement. We are encouraging law enforcement and fire to continue to order from their regular vendors and to buy on the open market those items of personal protective equipment they need. Agencies will be eligible for reimbursement. If agencies cannot buy on the open market, requests can be made through FEMA via the State Emergency Management Agency. We will continue to do whatever is necessary to put PPE into the hands of those that need it, be it hospitals or first responders. Along those same lines, earlier this week, we had first responders who responded to a person with COVID-19 positive. They donned personal protective equipment and took care of business. They were later quarantined. It is guidance from the Department of Health and Senior Services, as well as the infectious disease experts, that properly donned personal protective equipment does protect first responders. They must discard it properly upon completion of the call, and they will be eligible to continue to respond to other calls needing their service, all the while paying attention to the need for personal protective equipment. Additionally, we have public safety answering points across the state, dispatch centers. It is acceptable for 911 and dispatchers, to ask persons about COVID-19. They must ask questions to provide our first responders information to keep everyone safe. Dispatchers may ask about medications, they may ask about travel, and they may ask about exposure or testing positive for COVID-19. This is all being done to protect the lives of those serving our Missourians. Thank you.
Let me just say how much I appreciate the directors and the people in the cabinet for working for working every day to make sure they provide service to the Missouri citizens across this state. For them and their teams, I think it's quite evident after last week, whether you're in the legislation, whether you're a state employee, the COVID-19 can reach out and touch any of us at any time. I also want to thank the state employees across the state for staying the course, for coming to work every day and providing the services for Missourians. Those things are what's important at the end of the day, that we continue to do our jobs here at the state. So that I'm going to open it up for a few questions, and then I'll make a closing remarks here in a few minutes. Kelly? Yeah, we actually have a procedure and policy in place how we're going to deal with them, like the Truman Billion, how we would cut off a section of that building and isolate that. And so we're take care of that where people can come back to work, take those people out. There's a plan in place for that, same way at the Capitol, where there's certain things we'll do here at the Capitol. But, you know, for the governor's office, I got to be here. You know, I'm going to have to be in here every day, so we got to figure out how we can make it safe and how we can get it. And there's precautions we'll start taking as we go along. Again, you know, I want to emphasize one thing to everybody. Every day this changes. Every day these directors come up here and speak to you about different policies, about different waivers, but tomorrow it could change again. It's just a moving target every day to what we do up here. So, but yeah, we take precautions like that, like everybody else. And I would sure make sure the public, again, the order that I just read, all those things are so important. Doesn't matter whether you're in the Truman Building here in Jeff City or wherever you're at in the state, you gotta adhere to those warnings, and you gotta make sure you understand that order. And the thing, again, it comes back to people's responsibility to make sure they do that.
Dr. Williams, obviously social distancing is pretty difficult at grocery stores. Do you have any specific advice for shoppers and even just to have some peace of mind or things to stay healthy there?
Again, this is a part of our natural evolution with social distancing. We very much appreciate this directive from the governor. But it recognizes that there are essential services that have to be provided, going to the doctor, going to pharmacies, going to the grocery store. I was there this morning. And so what we would ask people to do when they do that, again, is to use good hand washing, use social distancing. Many of that's automated now, so when you use machines, make sure afterwards, again, you use hand sanitizer and that. But we think that this is going to be very effective and helping us decrease the number of people who are infected. So we very much welcome it and very much hope that people will very much take it in the spirit that's intended, realizing that there are some things that people have to do and just to do those using good practices. Thank you.
Well, I think every day we're looking how we can help businesses. I think we got people working in here almost around the clock looking for business waivers, looking at the regulatory environment, how we could do that. And how financially are we going to help? I know the director was in here yesterday talking about unemployment, how that's going to affect us. Look, there's going to be many people lose their jobs before this is over. But, you know, the main thing you got to do is you got to try to figure out how you can keep the businesses open as long as we can keep them open safely to make sure people maintain those jobs. And that's important to me every day. I'm trying to figure out how can we help those business owners, especially those small business owners, the mom and pops out there, trying to figure out how you keep their doors open at a time like this. Because losing employees is one thing, but if you lose your employees and you lose your business at the same time, that has a tremendous effect on the economy of the state.
Governor, in regard with the Illinois governor's decision yesterday to issue a shelter-in-place order, was there any cross-state communication on that, or what's Missouri's role as a neighbor in that, and has it affected your thinking at all?
Yeah, it really hasn't. I mean, every governor's going to have to figure out what decisions he makes in their states. You know, for me right now, if you do a stay order here, you know, for comparing Missouri and Illinois together or Kansas and Missouri together, you know, you got Kansas City sitting on the borders and St. Louis sitting on the borders. So how you do those situations is one thing. Each one of us governors got to make those decisions, and I got to figure that. Right now, I think this is the important order of the day. I think it's important. If for some reason this doesn't work, then we take another action at some point. But I think, again, it comes back to everybody understanding the importance of what we did today, about how important this is and how it is to make sure you abide by those rules. The other thing I think we got to realize, these numbers are going to continue to go up. There's going to be more testing done every day. These numbers are going to go up. The only way that they're ever going to go down is through the responsibility of people maintaining what these orders are about, listening to the public officials for safety concerns for everybody's health. That's what's going to have to happen. That's the way those numbers are going to level off, and that's the way they're going to go the other distance or the other way. But I think it's important you've got to abide by these rules and these orders that we're making. It's just, I can't emphasize how important that is for the people of Missouri. Yeah. You know what? Tomorrow I'm going to be on the phone. Tomorrow I'll be at SEMA most of the day tomorrow. We won't have a press briefing tomorrow out there, but we'll be on the phones. We're going to be talking about the religious organizations across the state. We're going to start that process of actually explaining what role they can take in helping with this. Look, I understand the whole idea of the church. I get that. But right now there's other alternatives we can do to go in church on Sundays. And I think it's important the churches are going to have to abide by those self-discipline just as well as anybody else is. And I think they will. And I think we're going to be talking to people like them. We'll be talking to the mayors again tomorrow. But those are all the kind of things that we'll be doing. But again, the churches play an important role in this because the churches across the state probably have the outreach ability to reach so many people, you know, and to make sure they understand what the facts are, of what's real, what's not real. It's important. And they have that obligation to do that. So I think they're a valuable tool for how we move forward, and I think they'll be part of that. But they're going to have to be part of the solution. All right, let me just finish up, closing up here today. I just want to thank you all again today for taking the time this week to come to these briefings. I cannot emphasize enough how critical it is for all Missourians to practice social distancing and to abide by the order. This order is intended to keep Missourians safe and healthy, backed by intense deliberation and knowledge. And it does not stop here. Stay informed on the ever-evolving situation. This means keeping up to date on the facts and not letting yourself be consumed by fear. If you don't have to get out, stay home. This is a public health emergency, and we must take all steps necessary to stop the spread of COVID-19. This is a serious time for our state and our nation, but I am reminded of how strong Missourians are together, and we will continue to move Missouri forward and overcome the challenges of tomorrow. Thank you very much. Thank you.